Thank you and welcome to our talk about WOPFINE Security. I'm Philipp. I'm a security researcher at Fraunhofer SIT in Darmstadt, Germany. I'm working in the secure software engineering department where I'm developing techniques for detecting vulnerabilities in IoT devices and mobile apps, and this in a static manner.
Yeah, hello. My name is Stefan. I'm also working at the Fraunhofer as a security researcher in the Test Lab Mobile Security Group. And there my focus is developing code analysis tools. And in my spare time, I'm looking at the IoT stuff and IoT security. And also in the spare time, together with another colleague, I founded a small hacking group consisting of students and employees, and we're doing security projects.
So first of all, some acknowledgements to Michael Dröger, Andreas Wittmann, and Alexander Trout, who supported us within this project, but couldn't be here today except of Alexander Trout. In recent years, we had several projects which we did together within the Team SIG, and we also presented them on big conferences. And after last year's DEF CON, we were thinking about what kind of project can we do next in order to get to big conferences again. And we were thinking about something with a wide distribution in order to have a lot of targets you can attack when, after you found some vulnerabilities. These devices need to have complex software in order to have interesting bugs. And it needs to be readily accessible. Because if you cannot access the devices or the things you found bugs in, nobody cares about your vulnerabilities. And we were thinking about things everybody has, and we came up with VoIP phones. They are located in every enterprise, on every desk you find a voice over IP phone. So you have a kind of device category with a really wide distribution. And every of those phones runs a web server for configuration purposes and administration. And so the complex is high enough to find good bugs. But what about the accessibility? Normally you would argue that you configure your network properly and you put your VoIP phones in a separate network and they only can connect to their SIP server and nobody can really access it. But if you're familiar with company networks, you know that it sometimes looks like this, that everything is connected into one network and that you have a lot of attackers available or able to reach these kind of phones. And as nobody disables the configuration web server, if the web server stays open and contains bugs, they are accessible from everywhere and also from the internet, as we will see later. This talk is structured as follows. We will give some short background information about how VoIP phones are designed. Then we give a little introduction of how we hacked the phones or how we proceeded with our research here. Then we will present our findings, and in the end, we will conclude the work. So, starting with the background. All of these VoIP phones have a similar structure. Normally, they run a MIPS or ARM CPU, and on top of this, they have a standard Linux operating system. There's a kernel and some standard processes which are on every phone, like the init process, some watchdogs, and the SIP daemon for the actual voice communication. Our target of attacks are the web servers. These are especially interesting because normally they run as root, and if you find a bug there, you normally own the phone. What did we do to find the vulnerabilities? You see an abstract overview. We first set up the phone as a regular user would do it, so configuring it, setting it up that everything runs and that you're able to communicate with the phone. Afterwards, we attach a classic HTTP proxy in order to do some web pen testing to getting familiar with how the phone works and how the communication is going on. Sometimes you find interesting stuff right away. Sometimes you don't find enough stuff there. Then we extracted the firmware in order to statically take a look at it, to extract some secrets which reveal information which lead to more interesting findings. And if this is not enough, we try to emulate the firmware in order to do some dynamic analysis. For instance, when you find a crash, then you further investigate by dynamically looking at it. There's one exception. If you find, for instance, a command injection, you may be able to inject dynamic analysis tools on the real device, so you don't need to emulate in order to do the dynamic analysis. Here's an overview of tools we used. I won't go into detail here. I think the slides will be available. You can check it out later. What to do about accessing the firmware? First of all, we don't use complex hardware setups or desoldered chips from the phones. We are software people, and we don't have so much budget, so we use the low-cost variations or the variants for getting the firmware from the chip. But first of all, we try to download the firmware from the vendor's homepage, because sometimes they provide the complete firmware package, and so you don't need to open the device or connect something. You just download the firmware and can extract it, and you're done. If this doesn't work because only diffs or patches are available on the homepage, you can try to trigger an update process from the phone and capture the traffic and then sniff the content of the firmware. But if you're in a up-to-date state, you cannot trigger the traffic, or it's encrypted or pinned, the last chance is to grab the firmware from the device itself. Stuff we used is, for instance, the JTAGulator, a bus pirate, and a bus pirate. These two devices did a pretty good job for us. There are other interfaces available which are similar. Here's an example. If you open the device and you check the chips on the device, you can locate the chip type, check the data sheet, and see which kinds of connectors are available on this chip. And if you find, for instance, the SPI, you can connect the bus pirate to it, and then you can connect this directly to your computer and dump the firmware. Here are some example commands how to do it. As you see on the bottom, it's not the most stable connection, as different dumps produce different output variations. The MD5 sum changes, but in the end, it's sufficient to extract the firmware and get all the data you need. Another example is a UART connection. If you find the UART pins on the device, you can connect the JTAGulator and get a serial console to it. Then sometimes you can boot into the bootloader, and there you have a limited set of commands there are commands available. And if you're lucky, you get the dump flash memory command, where the flash memory is printed on the screen. It's not direct dump, but if you're a little bit tricky or creative, you can copy the data from it and reassemble the data. If you're even more lucky, you directly get a root shell with a UART connection, and then you can access all the data. Then you just need to be a little bit creative of how to move the data from the root shell to your computer. Another interesting way is using a command injection. If you are able to execute commands within the web interface, you can start a telnet daemon, and then you have the same thing like a root shell, as all these web servers run as root, and you can start up a telnet daemon, you connect to it, and you have root, and then you can dump the data and find a bug to circumvent the authentication, for instance. Here are some interesting commands of how to get software on the phone. As you can imagine, not all the tools are available on the phones right out of the box, so you need to find ways to get data onto the phones in order to dump the data and the firmware off the phones. Next step is emulation. If you have all the data you need to emulate the web server, you can emulate it. There are multiple ways of doing the emulation. What we did is the system mode emulation, and this looks like this. We just take a QEMU image for ARM or MIPS CPUs with the Raspbian on top, and then putting all the data from the web server inside a change root environment, and then you're nearly done. Almost all the time you need to patch the binaries, as they expect some hardware interfaces which are only available on the phones. So you can patch the binaries or hook the methods or change some shell scripts which are looking for specific hardware stuff which is not available in your emulator. But then you're hacking a little bit, and then you can start the web server and do your dynamic analysis with, for instance, GDB, GDB server, S-trace, whatever you want to do. So now to the interesting stuff, our findings. The first category we focused on was denial of service. As you imagine, these phones are used in critical infrastructures or hospitals, and in case they don't work there, it can cause severe damage. And there are multiple ways of causing a denial of service in these phones. I will present a few of them. The first thing we found by accident, I mean, we checked for an Nmap scan at the first moment we get the phones, and then we realized that for one phone it was too much to scan the phone, and it caused a denial of service for like 5 or 10 minutes. Maybe you should spend a little bit more resources to at least stand an Nmap scan. The next thing we found by fuzzing for like 5 minutes, and you see the field username is a little bit extended by ACE, and this was enough to cause a null pointer dereferentiation, as there's the implementation makes a string compare with the actual field or the attribute of the field username, and as the username field is not available in the request, it just checks or compares with a null pointer, and this causes a segmentation fault and causes the phone to reboot. And we don't know why people are implementing this on their own if you're not capable of doing so. There is plenty of software around to use in order to avoid these kind of issues. A lot of phones use the LightTPD, the mod auth module, and it's implemented properly, and you don't have issues in the one of the most critical parts of your software. Can anybody imagine what's the issue here? It's the double quote. I mean, you put a double quote in this GET request, and it causes a assertion fail and causes the phone to reboot. I mean, the reboot takes like 5 minutes, and so with a simple GET request, you cause a denial of service for 5 minutes. At least it's not more severe damage here, but whether this is good or bad error handling, I think everybody can decide can decide himself. The next interesting category, as in all of our projects, we have some kind of bad crypto implementation. The Equivox R50 phone claims to... Is it me? Okay, I don't move. So it claims to encrypt the settings. It has a functionality to export the configuration in order to use it for other phones or to back it up or do whatever with it. But the issue here is it contains all your credentials from the SIP server and from the web interface, so there's sensitive information inside. But it seems like it's encrypted. You get a tar file which you cannot open, so it looks fine at the first sight. But checking what they actually do for encrypting is a little bit weird. And by deeper looking at it, you see it's just putting some values in front of the tar file and moving a little bit, and then what in the end happens is like they serialize the settings, creating a tar file and then removing the matching bytes. So it's not encrypted at all. Just because a standard archive manager cannot open it doesn't mean it's encrypted. We wrote a little script to decrypt the files, and as you see here, it's no rocket science. We just put the magic bytes in front and shift and skip the first 13 bytes, and we can open the files with the credentials inside. So as I mentioned, we did a lot of we did web pen testing, and we found the common, the usual suspects, like the Auswald is able to import a phone book. And imagine you get a phone book from your colleague and you import it, and you don't expect them to execute JavaScript on your phone, but you can do it. So beware of foreign or untrusted phone books. Or as well, please sanitize the input or the output. Next category, CSRF. Imagine the case, the scenario, your phone is behind a NAT router, an attacker cannot directly reach it and has no connection to it, but is able to send a URL to somebody inside the network, and in the moment the person triggers clicks on the link, he triggers actions inside the phone by either using a session he already opened, or in this scenario the attacker can send a link for creating a session, assuming he knows the admin password, but it's not uncommon that default passwords aren't changed, and then he can send a link for logging in and for enabling a SSH shell with the password he decides. Or there are other functionalities like establishing a VPN connection, and if he has a VPN server and is able to let the phone connect to its VPN server, then yeah, you have a problem. So be careful with the GET parameters. There's an RFC for this, how to use it and for which kind of data to use it, or you can use NDCSRF tokens. I think there's plenty of literature out there how to prevent these kind of attacks. The next interesting suspect or phone is the GigaSet. For this phone, we set it up as every phone and just analyzed the traffic and saw and looked around what's suspicious. And we found this endpoint, the parameters endpoint, and we saw that it returns different data, and we in the first moment we weren't sure what it actually means. But what it means is you can ask the phone whether the admin is currently logged into the phone, which is weird. I mean, you might say, yeah, it's not that bad, right? You just know when the admin is doing his job. But it's not it's an information leak, and you should avoid these kind of things. And we checked what's actually going on because we were curious. We found the code snippet deciding or implementing this behavior. And to explain this in detail, normally the admin logs in, gets a session token. The session token is stored in the database. And if an attacker sends his invalid session token, as he doesn't know the admin session token, the phone can decide that he is not permitted to do his actions. And then the implementation explicitly says if the admin is logged in and you provide a session token which is invalid, then we tell you that the admin is logged in, which just doesn't make sense. And then we dig a little bit deeper. We extracted, as you might imagine, we extracted the firmware, and it was all PHP files, so the implementation could be clearly audited and there was no obfuscation or whatsoever. And we found out how they implement their authorization process. Normally, if you provide your session token, it checks whether or which user ID belongs to the session token, and if the session ID is greater than 0, you are allowed to do your actions. I mean, it's not the most elegant way of implementing your session handling whatsoever, but it does its job. Then we looked a little bit more into the firmware, and we found this snippet of code. And what it's implementing is settings. So you if somebody is logged in, this kind of method is invoked, and you can set all kind of settings, including the admin password. So it's a critical functionality here. And as we saw before, they're checking whether the session is valid and there's a user ID, but then they're not checking whether the user ID is greater than 0, and they change the settings. This means somebody who sends a request without knowing the session token can set the admin password and therefore can circumvent the authentication process and exclude the actual admin from doing his job. And this I will show you in a demo. Stepping back. So on the left you see the victim, on the right you see the attacker, and on the bottom the attacking script. It's just a shell script checking whether the admin is logged in by sending a request to the parameters interface, and it has the request for setting the password or setting a new password. So you see here the admin is not logged in. Now the admin logs in, and in the moment the admin logs in, the password is changed. You see on the top the admin just idles a little bit and then logs out again. As you see here, to change the password, you don't need to know the new password. We saw the implementation. It doesn't check the old password. And now the attacker can log in again with the password he just set. And you will see here that he's the admin. So that's from my side. Stefan, please.
Okay. So another type of finding we had is command injection. The most devices we saw had a web interface and provide some kind of diagnostic feature. The screens all look similar. As you can see here, there's some kind of field where I can put in an IP address and the phone will ping the IP address. This is for configuration or check if everything is running. And if you look in detail, this IP address is send it to the web server, handled by some CGI script. And when you look at the code, you can see the IP address is forwarded, inlined, and then forwarded to the libc system function, and the system function will execute our ping command. And the problem is, in the most devices we saw, there's no escaping, sanitization, or whatever. So this means when you make another input, as in Linux, you can concatenate comments with a semicolon. So as you can see, we enrich our ping command. The hashtag is a comment field. Our comment is inlined again. And when you look at the string executed from system, you see our ping command. The menu C is just reducing the counter to 0. Then the ls command is executed and the rest is commented out. And this is some type of command injection we saw on a lot of devices. And the other thing is, as Philip already mentioned, the web server is running with root privileges. This means when you trigger a root shell or some other command, this is done in the context of the root. Another type of injection is sometimes the input parameter, the external input values, are forwarded to some shell script. Here you see some script which should handle the logging. And when you enter an IP address for the logging server, this is forwarded to the shell script. And you see the internal field separator is just splitting up our IP address to the $1 to $4 variables. And the idea is now to check if the value is between 0 and 255. So if the token is valid. But the question is now, the field separator is reacting on a dot, but when our input has no dot and we close the brackets, what will happen? And if you see at this command, so for instance, we inlined again our pin command, we closed the bracket, semicolon, pin command, and a comment. And on a host, we were listening, and you can see the device will ping our host. So this means this is another way of comment injection. So how to exploit it, we will see later. Another interesting thing we found on this device was when we do a port scan that there's some telnet running. And so we thought, okay, telnet is there. Let's try to connect, but it's asking for a password. And as for this device, the firmware was not public. We don't know the password. When you go back to our common injection, the problem was also we had not enough material to make a remote shell, though there was no netcat. We were not able to upload anything. There was no useful binary. But then we thought, okay, we have already a telnet. Let's do a simple trick. And we just injected a command to delete the root password. So when you look at this, this is the curl request. And we just triggered with our command injection the passvd command -d, which will delete the root password. And as the web server is running as root, we can delete its own password. And we can use our telnet to connect. So we will show this in the demo. On the left side, you will see again, at first you see our scan. Telnet port is open. So here you can see it's requesting or asking for the password. We don't know it, so we cancel it. What's important? On the left side, you see the admin logged in. So this kind of attack is not a full pre-out bypass. So this means you have to know at least the user credentials for the web server. This is just some kind of privilege escalation. This means if you can access the web interface and have the credentials, you can escalate to the full root system privileges. So here you see the user logs in. I don't know if you can see it on the video. It just has to copy the login session to our exploit script. Another interesting thing of this session is we analyzed the device, and the length of the session on this device was an average 4 characters. In the most cases, it had 3 characters, sometimes 5, but you can imagine a session length of 4, not characters, let me say 4 digits, is not the best entropy for a session. And then you can see we forward our session ID, trigger our command injection. Oh, sorry. And we could log in without the password. So this was some kind of privilege escalation. But then we thought, okay, there's already a telnet. We deleted the root password. So if we somehow get access to the firmware, perhaps then we can abuse this backdoor. And when we look at the manual of the device, we don't find anything to turn off the telnet. So this means this telnet service is always running. The firmware image is not public available, but as Philip already explained in the introduction with the SPI, we were able just to dump the firmware, and from there we got the hashes. And when you look at the password hashes, they look a bit small, and this is just a DS crypt system. This means by design the password has a maximum length of 8 when you try to crack it. And I tried to crack it on my old GPU. I had some NVIDIA card, I think 4 or 5 years old, and it took me 30 days. So you can imagine if you have a more modern GPU, you can crack it much faster. And with these credentials, then you can log in as root user. Okay, the last type of vulnerabilities, some classics, buffer overflows. There were also buffer overflows on the devices. Here you see a small code excerpt. So we will show now some exploits for the ARM. We also have had some MIPS devices and exploited them too. But here for this presentation, we just show the ARM. And as you can see, in this code excerpt, we have some host name and manufacturer name. These are external parameters. And as you also can see here, we have the string copy instruction, and everybody knows external input and string copy. Yeah. The most cases, it fails. So when you see at the debug output, it's some classic buffer overflow. We simply can't control the program counter with this input. So what are now the challenges to exploit it? Of course, you have some forbidden characters in your shellcode, NX protection, ISR, caching, finding the stack, and all the mitigations. And the first question was, how can we bypass NX and ISLR? Very easy. Nearly all devices have no mitigations. They all run plain. I think we had one or two which has NX protection, but the rest of our 30 devices had non-mitigations. So then we need some kind of shellcode. You can use some tools to auto-generate it, or you can code it by yourself to keep in training. We decided to write it by ourselves. What we just need is some exec VE and trigger the telnet daemon, because on the target device was a busy box supporting telnet. Here you can see the first part of our shellcode is just an instruction to switch to thump mode, because in thump mode the instructions are shorter and we can avoid 0 bytes. Here you see now the rest of our shellcode. The first is, I think most of you are aware, if not, the parameters are in ARM instructions are stored in register 0 to 4. So in the first register, R0, we store our string for the busy box, the common interpreter. In the second parameter, we have our telnet daemon, which we want to start. For exec VE, we need to build an array, because the second parameter must be an array. So we pushed our registers on the stack. And the last thing is, as you can see at the end of the strings, we have X. This is because of the null termination of the strings. We will replace this X with some store byte instructions. And then we trigger the syscall, and this will start our telnet daemon. Another challenge was, how can we find our stack address? And in ARM or in x86, this can be very easy. There are some gadgets, some branch to the stack pointer or jump to ESP. So we used some tool. It's called, I think most people know it, it's called Ropa. It's very helpful for finding gadgets. And we used it to find the gadget in the libc. And that was our gadget. And now we have all components to build our exploit code. Here you see the excerpt. At the beginning, we have the base address of our libc. Here's our encoded shellcode, the payload. This is just a helper function for the Python script. Here we have our branch instruction, which will jump to the stack pointer and then trigger our shellcode. We made a short demo. Okay. So here at the beginning, you see again, this is just the assembly of the shellcode I showed on the slides. Here's the Python script containing the exploit. And we had also a short shell script, because I'm not a Python guy. I was too lazy to implement the get request, so I combined the Python script with the curl request. And then here you see for the manufacturer name, I replaced it with the payload. The strange thing is, sometimes when we triggered the exploit in the first case, it was not running. I think it's some kind of caching problem. We didn't analyze it in detail, but then we received, we achieved to trigger the telnet daemon. The problem is now again, you need some credentials. And yeah, on the device, we had the classic root, and then you get, your root shell again. Instead of triggering, the telnet daemon, you can also wrote your own ARM reverse shell. We also tried this, but for this demo, we just showed the telnet, because then you see also again the password policy on these devices, classic root. So this is the end of the findings. Here you see again tables. These are the devices we analyzed. For the most critical findings, we registered also CVEs. On a few devices, we had no findings, but this does not mean that they are secure. Perhaps we are just too stupid. One device we bricked. And the bottom, you also find a link with advisories where all our findings were described, the exploits, proof of concept, and so on, are there in PDFs. This is some kind of matrix. You see again the on the left side the devices, and on the right side all the type of vulnerabilities we found. And you see a lot of command injections, CRF, buffer overflows, path traversals, and all classic vulnerabilities. The problem is also we wanted to get some numbers, how much devices are affected, but from the vendor you will not get any numbers. And as Philip says, in the most infrastructures, the devices are internal, so you also don't get any numbers. But we still were curious and just make some showdown queries. And here you see the top four most devices where the web interface publicly is exposed. So a few of them, just checked a few, also had the standard credentials or were vulnerable against the exploits. At the end, a few recommendations for people who has to administrate such devices. At the beginning, always change your default credentials. We saw a lot of them public. If there's an update, of course, update the firmware. Big problem is these devices have no auto-update features, so you have to regularly check it. If there are some external services like Telnet or SSH, or also the web interface, disable it if you don't need it. Also, Philip showed network protection measurements. For developers, yeah, the classic things. The web server must not run as root. Use compiler flags. Also try to enforce credential change on the startup of the device. We had one device which implemented it very good. So when you started it the first time, he enforces you to change, for instance, the credentials for the web interface. It also implemented the password policies. And also, as we know it from, for instance, from routers, implement some kind of auto update or some remember function to update the firmware. The last thing is something from our perspective, perhaps where you can think about it. As you realize, the slides have a light touch of Back to the Future, and you want to make a short time travel. So when we get back to 1991, 92, Linux was released. Everybody knows it's a multi-user system. We have privilege separation, and so let's say a good design. A few years later, we realized, okay, there's a problem. There are some kind of bad C functions, which can be a problem for the security if they're used in the operating system or in applications. So people started to develop mitigations like NX, ISLR. Now we also have control flow integrity and so on. And if you all combine, a modern desktop Linux system is not bulletproof, but with all the mitigation, it's getting harder, or it's harder to exploit it. So then when we go forward in time, this next generation of devices was brought to the market, the smartphones. When you look at the first smartphones, you see again, the iPhone, all apps were run as root. There was just a root user. So we decided again, let's introduce mitigations. So they introduced mitigations like ISLR and X and so on. And when you look now in our time, we heard it also yesterday from the colleagues about the printer. We are in the, let's say, time of IoT. Also, when you look at the vulnerabilities and bugs in the VoIP devices, this is a state of 92. So in my opinion, something there went wrong. To sum up what we did, so we had all in all 33 different VoIP phones from different manufacturers. We found 40 vulnerability. The most critical, we registered CVEs. And there's a lot of old technology out there. But what we also saw, it's getting better, especially when you look at the flagship phones and the more modern. They switched from Linux to Android. And on one side, Android had a few advantages because you don't have a root user, you have sandboxing, you have some virtual machine on it. But on the other side, you introduce some kind of new vulnerabilities, because then they provide features that you can install apps on your desktop phone. So then you have an Android browser or Android apps on your desktop phone. Why ever, or who needs it, I don't know. But with this feature, you introduce new types of vulnerability. So we cannot get in the future. We don't know what will happen. But I think when we look 20, 30 years in the future, don't know, spaceships, flying cars, cyborgs, whatever, as long as someone is using C code, I think you will find some service running as root and containing some memory corruptions. So this is the end of our presentation. Here is our contact information. So if you have any questions, feel free to ask, or also later we are around the conference. So thank you again.